Welcome to the Leadership School Podcast. I'm your host, leadership and self-care coach, Kyla Kofer. Here at the Leadership School, you'll hear leaders from around the world sharing their stories and expertise on how to lead with balance and integrity. Our goal? Teach you how to be an extraordinary leader. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Leadership School. I'm here today with Marie Claire Ross, the founder and owner of Trustology and the author of Trusted to Thrive. So guess what we're talking about today? That's right, trust. She trains people on how to build and maintain trust. So we're going to talk some specifics, the how and why of trust. We're going to talk about building trust during times of stress, how to rebuild trust when it's broken, and more. So join me in welcoming Marie Claire Ross and an amazing conversation on how to build and develop trust. Marie Claire, I'm really, really excited to talk to you today. We've been talking for a while and we've actually just met recently, but like I have been reading your book and I can't wait to talk about it here. I really believe that this is a book that every leader needs to read and I can't wait to read it again because I think it's so powerful and practical and just really helpful. So before I go any further and keep bragging about how great you are, why don't you just go ahead and tell our audience about yourself and maybe tell us about your book. You've got it up there behind you, which was kind of fun and a little fun adventure getting it set up there. I love that. But yeah, why don't you just go ahead and jump in and you can tell us all about yourself and then we'll really talk about this book and why everybody needs to read it.
Yeah, thanks, Kyla. Well, I work with leaders and teams to help them build trust with each other and throughout their teams and the organization. And I've been doing this. I started my business Trustology back in 2014, and it all came about because I was running my own business and working with companies. And I was really shocked at how people were treated because to get good staff, I had to work with them and look after them. And I was quite shocked that that still wasn't being, that wasn't the case so much in the corporate world. So I decided to go out there and teach leaders how to build trust because the results are really fabulous. And, we all thrive and feel good about ourselves when we're with people who trust us and who we trust as well. And so my book is really a guidebook for leaders on how to do that.
So it's called Trusted to Thrive. It's up there behind you. And when did you publish it? Last year?
No, this year. Came out in March. And it was written during the pandemic because in Australia we had a lot of lockdowns. And so I had time to think about stuff. And leaders were actually coming to me and saying, well, how do I create a culture within my team? I'm worried that the organization's values are going to be lost when I don't get to see my team every day. And how do I make people still, people were quite uncertain and fearful. And in fact, we still are. There's so many things going on in the world that it's probably a constant, how do you help your employees feel, certain and good about what's going on when there's so much turmoil going on in the world as well?
Yeah. So your business is named Trustology.
Yeah.
That is such a great, great name. It's so cool. So what is interesting to me, though, is I can see the benefit of how important it is to build trust in an organization. And I'm wondering, how are people noticing that this is something that they need to pay attention to and focus on? Because I tend to think in a lot of organizations, they're more thinking about how can I get better results? And so they might not be coming and looking and recognizing that, oh, I just need to build more trust. So how are you getting that message out that really the issue is you need to gain more trust?
Yeah, well, what a lot of organizations find is that particularly when they've got new leadership, so say new CEO, new leadership team, and the business might not be doing that well and there's a need to renew and refresh and people are leaving, the culture might be toxic due to really not so great CEO or executive team or leaders. And people are leaving the organization because it's not great. In fact, there was a study that was done at the start of the year and they actually found that, we've all heard of the term the great resignation and everyone thinks people are leaving their jobs because of, burnout or not able to work flexibly or poor pay. But what the study found is that people are leaving jobs where there's a toxic culture. And in fact, they found that a toxic culture is 10.4 times more powerful than compensation in predicting a company's attrition rate compared with its industry. So it's a really big issue. And I find a lot of companies, when they're going through that change and overhauling their culture and their strategies, they realize, oh my gosh, trust is broken. And it really impacts all the employees all the way down to the front line. And you'll find that they're really resistant to change. They might even be quite entitled. Any decisions that the leaders make, they don't think much of because they just don't trust them. And so what you'll find is that, you know, trust really shows itself when you've got really bad leaders or had them and you're trying to recover from that and get better performance.
So we're here talking about trust, and all I'm thinking is like when someone changes the expectations on us at some point, like that breaks that trust that we have with people a little bit. Like I'm talking here and all of a sudden my lawn care person showed up in the middle of recording an episode and I wasn't expecting that. And I feel like sometimes that does change things. And sometimes that trust gets broken because maybe an expectation is changed and we have to constantly be working to build that in order to really succeed.
Yeah, it's that consistency of behaviors over time. It's so important.
Oh, okay. So in your book, you talked about that, consistency in behaviors over time. Mm. We talked about, I'm trying to think through your book because your book is so helpful and it really outlines what trust is, why it's important. And you really break it down in, like, you've got your four zones that we're going to talk about here in a second, and you break all these things down. But one thing that really stuck out to me that you said is that trust isn't something that you automatically get. It doesn't just show up. Trust has to be earned, and it takes a time to earn that, but it also has to be kept up, because if you let go of that trust, then it's gone. I mean, it does have to continue to be kept up over time. So let's talk about that for a minute, about all of those different elements. I would love to hear about your four zones, but maybe you can just tell me a little bit more about what that looks like to build that trust, and how are we keeping that over time? Because like I said, I have trusted that my lawn care guy would only come on Saturdays or Sundays. And here it is on Thursday. And now I'm in the middle of recording something and that threw things off for me. So having that thing can really shift someone's mind.
So trust is very much like a battery. So if you imagine a battery that's full, that battery will actually decline over time if we don't recharge it. And it's like relationships. You've got to keep working on it. You can't assume that because you've built trust with someone, it's going to last. You know, some relationships, you know, might, but if you do the wrong thing or say the wrong thing or miss an expectation or miscommunicate, then trust can fall. And then it's really hard to recover from that. And in fact, building trust is so important. That's what you've got to be keeping in your mind all the time, because if you lose trust with someone, it is so much harder to fix. It's better to always constantly be working on it or monitoring it. And I find really good leaders do that at some level, you know, on a weekly basis. So, you know, where we can accidentally lose trust is if we assume we've got it and we're not working on it. If we think that people have to show us and prove to us they can be trusted, that actually works against us. I don't know if you've ever had an experience where you've had a person in your life that hasn't trusted you and you've felt that, or they've told you, it's really quite upsetting. And I don't know if you're like me, I don't have oppositional defiance disorder, but I tell you what, someone, you know, lets me know they don't trust me or takes away a right or something, I get a little bit naughty and might not do things or ignore an email or, you know, like that, because I think, well, you don't trust me, is what I get.
It's really hurtful. It feels like an attack against your character when someone says that, even if it's with something small. What, you don't trust me with this? I mean, what have I done wrong? Like, I've done everything to earn your trust. Like, then it's like, it really does feel like not just an attack on your character, but on your person.
Yeah. Like when I grew up, my mother would say to me a lot, I don't trust you as far as I can throw you. I still don't quite know what that means. But anyway, it used to really upset me because I think, but I'm doing everything to please you. What else can I do? But, you know, some people aren't very trusting of others. And so we need to keep that in mind, and they need a bit more work, but sometimes, you know, sometimes we might just want to avoid them as well. But it's this constant process of, you know, really working with people, figuring them out, understanding what they need, because we usually assume that the way to build trust with someone is what we need. So a lot of, you know, I get a lot of leaders that will say to me, oh, it's easy. You just tell the truth and, you know, be consistent. Well, telling the truth can be hard when you're a leader. There are some things you can't talk about due to legal issues, or, you know, some things are confidential. So you can't always tell the truth. You can't explain what's going on, because the company might be in the process of being sold and you can't say anything to anyone.
But also sometimes telling the truth, like, you have to be careful with how you do that, not just because of the content, but the way in which you say something. I could tell you the truth about something, but, you know, like if my husband says, yeah, that dress makes you look hideous, I mean, that might be truthful, but maybe I can, like, find a way to say that that doesn't make me feel hideous, you know?
That's so true. So this is what gets us stuck, is that we come from our perspective of what we think we want, but we're not really understanding what other people want. Your direct report might actually want you to be supportive of their career, or supportive of, you know, they might be going through some emotional health issues, or they might have some, they might be on the autism spectrum and they need you to kind of understand, well, sometimes they don't smile or say hello, or, you know, they don't, it's not because they're being mean, that's just how they are, and you have to respect that and work with that. So they're kind of the top things that I find that leaders, you know, just assume that they've got or they're doing. You know, the best way to know if you're trusted is to never actually go to someone and say, do you trust me? That's the worst thing you can say. You know, one of the things that I unpack in the book is how the brain works. And it's about, because what's really fascinating is that trust is processed through our limbic system, which is the old part of the brain, which is quite primitive. It's a survival brain designed to keep us safe. And it's where all the subconscious behaviors occur. You know, things like waking up in the morning, we don't have to remember how to walk because it's all stored in this part of the brain. So the good news is it means we can do other things. It also is where we process emotions such as trust and loyalty. So the really interesting thing about this part of the brain is that it has no ability to communicate in language or even understand language. It actually processes emotions through feelings. So as leaders, it's, you know, we can't talk our way into trust. We have to behave our way into it. Yet so many leaders, you know, will say, oh, you can trust me on this, or, you know, it's one of the worst things you can say early on in a relationship, because our brains are actually checking for that gap. You know, do people do what they say they're going to do? You know, one of the biggest complaints you'll see in employee engagement survey results are employees complaining about leaders not walking the talk. And what they're really saying is that their brains are looking for those signs that they can trust their leaders, and they're not, just not seeing it. So it's really important that as leaders, it's not just the words that you say, it's also your body language, your intonation, your tone. You know, are you doing what you say you're going to do? All those things consistently over time helps build trust with those around you.
Two things I'm thinking about is something you said a little bit earlier was that trust isn't automatic. And you've said that actually several times, but thinking about just because you're the boss, you've gotten this director position, CEO position, you're the manager, whatever, just because that's your title doesn't mean that you're going to earn the respect of the people that you're leading, because titles don't earn trust. It's people that earn trust. And I'm thinking too, like, you can walk, sometimes you can meet somebody and initially, like, immediately you feel that you could trust them, and immediately you could feel that you don't trust them, depending on who the person is. Because we do, it's that energy that we carry in our bodies of who we are and what we're portraying in our demeanor, in our actions. You know, like, animals can sense things like that, and in humans can too. It's learning to kind of trust your own intuition in that. And you even mentioned that in the book a little bit, your intuition.
Yeah. And you know what? It's a tricky one. So I'm probably going to throw a spanner in the works here. Like, I know with me, I'm a very trusting person, too trusting. And that's actually put me in positions where I've trusted people that I shouldn't have. And I've probably not listen to my intuition, but sometimes my intuition wasn't there. You know, there are people out there you can't trust. So people who are, you know, high on the narcissism spectrum or, you know, sociopaths, psychopaths, they really groom people and do what they can to pretend to be trustworthy when they're not. That's kind of what they do. Mm-hmm. And so it's really important to actually even understand the sorts of things that they do, the signs that they are, because we can accidentally, like I used to, trust those sorts of people because they were sending out the signals that I needed, not realizing they were just completely fake. Been a bit of a learning process, took me a long time to learn, but you know, that can be really important that we do put the right boundaries in place as well.
Oh my gosh, you just said my favorite word ever, boundaries. and you know what I really love though is in your book, you're breaking down these ways that you can understand that and establish that and build those boundaries in a unique way. And this perspective of, okay, yeah, well, I need to set boundaries with people so I don't trust too many people that I shouldn't trust. But how do you really start learning that and knowing that? And I think some of that is becoming a trustworthy person and becoming a person that people can trust and learning how to build that trust, not in a manipulative way, in a way of, because my actions are showing repeatedly that I'm showing up for you, that you can trust me because I've followed through. I've done what I said I'm going to do, those kinds of things.
Yeah. So what's really important, and I don't want to, I've got to make sure that I don't send the message, hey, just don't trust people, because that's the worst thing you can do.
No, you're not. You're not.
That's not what we wanted. I just wanted to put that caveat there. It's really about looking at the world and, you know, being trusting people and giving them the opportunity to shine and show you what they can do, rather than having that, oh, I don't trust you straight away because I don't know you, and lock yourself away. It's not good for the world. So it's really, and this is, I'm sure, something that you're very passionate about. It's really, you know, what I find is so important for leaders who are trusted is that they're self-aware. They've spent the time doing the work on personal development and learning about themselves. And it's really being aware of, you know, the sorts of people, who they are, their strengths and weaknesses. Over time, you do learn who you can trust. You know, I have little things that I look out for when I meet people, you know, those sorts of things that have been really good indicators. You know, for example, I had a meeting with a potential client. We had a lunch first, and that was lovely. And then when I came back to meet with him to discuss business, he was half an hour late. And then when I did sit with him to talk, he just couldn't focus and he wasn't really listening. I couldn't ask him. It was just, you know, we had 20 minutes. I wasted my time. And I realized, it's not going to be a good relationship. I'm going to walk away. So little things like that really help us. And you learn that through experience. But it's really being clear with your values, what's important to you, and digging into that. So one of the things I talk about in the book are the three trust forces. So these are forces that work for us or against us. And so if we don't trust ourselves, if we're not confident in who we are, then people pick up on that. And, you know, people aren't going to trust us if we're sending out a message, hey, I don't trust myself to be a leader. I don't know what I'm doing. So we've got to really, you know, spend the time. And, gosh, this can be a lifelong challenge, right? Is to trust who we are and what we can do. And, you know, at the bottom of that, of course, is loving ourselves and valuing ourselves. But from there, it radiates out and impacts your team, because how you behave and the communication and the interactions, your team are picking up on. So if you don't feel like you trust yourself or trust them, they pick up on that. So they model that and they reflect it back to you. So it's this really interesting, you know, push and pull dynamics of trust that, you know, you've got to be centered and focused and really clear on who you are and what you're trying to achieve and trust yourself. And from that, all things flow.
Yeah. And what I'm hearing is, you know, just a reminder that leaders means that people are following. So if you are leading and people are following you and whatever type of energy you're putting out, that's what people are following. And that's really important. Hey, can you talk a little bit about your four zones? You call them zones, right? Your four different zones and what they mean and what we're kind of looking for that can give us a better picture of what's actually happening in our relationships and business. This is an ad swap for the podcast Psyche Magic. For those of you that might be interested in the spiritual side of leadership, try checking out the podcast Psyche Magic. This is with psychotherapist Jordan Hale, and she's talking about how we can teach ourselves through our dreams. Jordan and her guests are offering some guided meditations, some reflections on what maybe the symbols in our dreams might mean for our waking life. I found it really helpful. You might too. So go check it out. You can find it at psychemagicpodcast.com and it's available on any podcast platform.
Yeah, well, you know, one of the things that I say is that leading a high performance team is a bit like taking your team on an elevator to the 150th floor of a building. You know, that's pretty scary. That's a very tall building. And, you know, if you can just imagine the leader on the ground floor saying, "Hey guys, come on, we're going to go to this 150th floor. Let's go." And everyone jumps on board excited. They're in the lift. They're talking excitedly about the goal. You know, what's it going to look like at the 150th floor? What are we going to see? What are we going to do there? It's going to be great. And, you know, there's this excited conversation. And then a couple of people say, "Oh gosh, I'm actually scared. I get really nervous with heights and my ears block." And everyone goes, "It's all right. We'll look after you." And so the team, you know, goes express all the way to the top. And then if you contrast that to another team where the leader goes, "All right, everyone, let's get on to the lift. We're going to the 150th floor." And a couple of people go, "Oh, hang on a minute. I'm just going to walk a couple of flights. I'll meet you at the third floor." And then the rest of the team get on and no one's talking. The doors close. There's the elevator music. It's really awkward. A couple of people talk about, you know, the sport on the weekend. Everyone's avoiding eye contact. They pick up the other people. No one looks at each other. And then without knowing, a couple of people are actually near the lift buttons and they, without letting anyone know, they start pressing some of the buttons. And all of a sudden this lift has to, you know, go from the third floor and stop at the 15th and the 34th and all these random things, and no one's admitting or being accountable to slowing down the lift, and it becomes really awkward and slow, and you know, they give up on their goal. And what's happening here is this little thing called interpersonal risk. You know, as human beings, we're actually driven all the time by a fear that other people won't accept us for who we are. And, you know, we're going to get kicked out of the team, but we're afraid to share it. So it's what's really interesting is this interpersonal risk is driving us, but we don't know. And we don't even vocalize it. So a lot of people who can be quite, you know, really hard to be around, they're angry, they get defensive. Sometimes that interpersonal risk is so strong that it just makes them angry because they're so fearful of actually doing the wrong thing by their team and getting kicked out, but not realizing that the behaviors they're exhibiting are going to get them kicked out anyway. So this is a fear that leaders need to understand, that all of your direct reports and even yourself are being guided by this fear. Dr. Amy Edmondson, she wrote a book called The Fearless Organization, and she coined the term psychological safety, which for those of you who don't know, is where you can be yourself, take risks, make mistakes, and be supported and embraced by those around you. They don't, you know, think you're terrible or anything or kick you out of the team, which we're so scared of. And what she found is that when you combined high psychological safety with high accountability, they collide to create high performance. So with that, I created 14 zones. So if you imagine, you know, an X and Y axis, and you can see high psychological safety and high accountability on that top right-hand corner, that's what I call the achievement zone. And then to the left of that, where you've got high accountability but low psychological safety, that's the anxiety zone. And the anxiety zone are really teams that are in high-pressure industries. It's all about results, not people. So everyone's working really hard. Deadlines are being met. Things are getting out. But there's this enormous pressure to do the work. There's not much support from the leader or from peers. It's very competitive. And you'll find in this zone that you get a lot of anxiety, a lot of burnout. And, you know, while you do achieve a lot, it's, you know, I don't know if you've heard that expression that we say in Australia, you know, it's either sink or swim.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And then underneath, you know, down right in the right-hand corner on the bottom quadrant where you've got high psychological safety but low accountability is what I call the abatement zone. Now, the abatement zone is where a lot of teams are, and it's actually a team that's had past success and thinks they're really good. They've got this sense of, you know, entitlement and hubris, but they don't realize that they're actually declining in performance because they're not improving. They're usually led by a leader who's not very accountable. It might be because they're stressed or got personal issues, or they're like, oh, I've achieved now, I don't have to do any more. But they don't realize that without that continual improvement of the system and looking at things differently, they're sliding in performance. And this is a zone where ideas go to die, where if you're a high performer, this zone's horrible because your peers will stop you when you come with new ideas or want to do things differently. It's very much about the status quo, being in that comfort zone, working 9 to 5 and escalating issues to the boss. So the team leader ends up with a bigger workload because their team are just not able to do much. And then you have the abatement zone, which is the worst zone. The apathy zone, which is the worst zone. It's low psych safety, low accountability. It can be led by a leader that prefers to do the work. It's not a people person. So they're not really into leading people. They're under managing their team. And that might be because, well, they don't know how to lead, or they don't really want to, or it could be because they're working on lots of different projects and they're taking up all their time. And so in this zone, it's a really tough place to be. A lot of people fall into this zone when they're looking for a new job, and it's where people are just, they're in survival mode. They're just focused on getting through the day and not getting told off. And, you know, there's conflict and blame and cynicism. And this is where, you know, toxic cultures really do hurt people psychologically.
So in a really low functioning team relationships, you're in this apathy, the state of apathy, the apathy zone, mm-hmm. which is low, what it's low support. What are your axes, the X and the Y? We're making a table here, a chart.
Sorry, I should have made that clearer. So X is psychological safety and Y is accountability. And so, okay. Yeah.
So in the apathy, we're low on psychological safety and low on accountability.
Yeah.
And then we're going to move up.
That's the anxiety zone.
The anxiety zone is going to be high on accountability, but yeah. low psychological safety.
Correct.
And then we move over to the abatement zone and it's flopped. We've got high psychological safety, but low accountability.
So what's really interesting in the abatement zone, even though there's safety, it's like a safety to not perform. You're okay. safe to yeah, just so, be, you know, continually doing what you're doing and not trying any harder. So it's kind of a fake safety.
Yeah, it's like you've met the bar and the bar is not that high and you're good there. You don't need to go higher than that. Everything's good and rosy, but you're happy. You just don't really want to go anywhere else.
Yeah. And so when the organization decides that, oh my gosh, this team's not performing, we're going to do something about it, that team will freak out and go, hey, sure. No, we're not changing. Everything's fine. And they'll start, you know, getting upset. And, you know, that's what makes change hard, because they're used to this cushy job where they can just keep doing what they're doing and not having to try. Because, you know, learning and doing things better, that can be hard.
Right. So this is why it's important to kind of identify where you personally are falling and where your team is falling. Like, are you feeling that apathy where you're just in the low performance, low accountability, you're not feeling safe where you are, you're feeling anxious, kind of finding where you are on that path and in those spaces can really help you determine, okay, if we have high accountability but low psychological safety, we're going to have high turnover because we're all feeling so anxious all the time that we're losing employees faster than we can hire them because people are stressed out and burnt out and our healthcare costs are through the roof because people are sick. Yeah. So it's really helpful to kind of determine where you are. Now, the goal, though, where we're trying to get to is the achievement zone, right? So where you're high on both areas. I'm curious because in your book, you said the achievement zone is hard to stay in for a long period of time. Are you finding that to be true, or are there people who have successfully maintained living in this high level achievement zone for the long term?
Yeah, that's a really good point. So I do a lot of research and I interview lots of people, and I actually found some achievement zone leaders. And by that, what they're doing is, and they're known to be that. So you'll find that an achievement zone leader will actually be brought into a team or a company to actually turn it around, because they have this track record of turning around, you know, an abatement zone team, an apathy team, even an anxiety team, and turning them into that high achievement zone team. And what I found when I interviewed these leaders who have this track record of doing this and creating millions of dollars worth of value in the companies they work in, is that they would spend time every week reviewing not just how, what their results were, but how they were getting results. So they would actually check using my achievement zone model, ask themselves some questions around that in terms of what they needed to do, you know, what behaviors they were doing. And they would ask themselves questions such as, you know, how have I created safety this week? How have I created connection this week? How have I communicated the future this week? And rank themselves with that and think about what they could do to improve that. So really trusted leaders spend that time reflecting every week on what they're doing and how they can do better. And it goes back to my thing earlier that being a trusted leader is about having that self-awareness. It's not about thinking, well, hey, I've got the title leader, I'm a leader. It's about working on it every single week.
Every week. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting because I'm seeing, I mean, I love patterns and I'm a life coach and I am a leadership coach, you know, so I talk about these things all the time with my clients and with just people in this podcast, but it's a pattern that every time we talk of consistency and slowing down, stepping back actually drives more results than pushing forward, of that taking time to reflect, to do your personal work, to pause, to rest, slow down. Every time we do that, we tend, our brain tells us, especially I'm in the US, in our culture here, it tells us if we slow or stop down, then we're failing. You know, we're not achieving something. But actually the exact opposite happens, that the more we slow down, the more we end up achieving and accomplishing. And so what you're telling me is that the people who are high achievers, who maintain high achievement in positive way with that psychological safety, are people who have a habitual practice of stepping back and slowing down and reflecting.
Yeah. Well, you know, what's really interesting, because I've done hundreds of interviews with CEOs and executives, and you go into their office and, you know, they'll make the time for you to interview them. And you go in and they're not hurried. They're not unfocused. They're not tapping their fingers, distracted. It's, you know, they usually don't even have anything on their desk. They have created this ability to have the time to speak to people because they know that's one of the most important things of their jobs. And they've delegated all the other tasks that other people can do. But they spend their time and their focus on people during the day, so, and being available. And they're not hurried. It's really interesting. But the ones that are flustered and running about and stuff like that and can't deal with people, usually not achieving as much. But just going back to your point about, you know, being in the achievement zone is difficult. So there's two reasons for that. We have to stay in that achievement zone, we have to be curious and exploring new ideas and looking at things differently all the time. That takes work and discipline. But what's really interesting is that in my research, what some of the leaders would say is that they would turn around a team or department and then everything would start working, and they were no longer getting that feedback that things were wrong, because the people, their direct reports, they had coached and managed so that they could deal with all the issues. So that's why they were so busy, so to speak, because all the problems were being dealt with and not even reaching them. And they get bored. And so what a lot of leaders do is they start to meddle, play around with stuff they should leave alone. That's when they might even start to micromanage. Everything's working. They're not getting feedback. Things are not working. So they get bored. So in those circumstances, what the best thing is for leaders like this is that they need a new project to keep them busy.
Yeah, you know, it's funny how we sometimes get comfortable having problems and we don't want them, but then when we don't have them, we have to create them because we're so comfortable having problems. You know, I say this with depression a lot because I've had a history of depression and anxiety, that when I'm ever in like a depressive state, that sometimes it can be hard to get out of because the depression gets to be more so comfortable and familiar that at that point we're just wanting to stay in that comfortable, familiar space instead of trying to get out of it, even though being outside of it is better for you. And so I think, you know, when you're saying that they get bored and they have to create something new to be exciting. And I'm wondering how much of that is going on, of that we're so used to having problems to fix that now that we don't have problems to fix, we don't really know what to do with ourselves. So it sounds like it's that's a new problem, is learning how to live in a healthy space can be hard.
Because when actually things start working out, your brain sometimes goes, when I'm just waiting for the other shoe to drop. Like, where's the chaos going to happen? It's going to happen. I know. So you're on this constant state of anxiety and high alert, and oh, it's not happening. I'll just make some chaos.
And so at this point, it's like learning to do that mindset shift of that, okay, I had the chaos, I've solved the chaos, and now I have to look at things differently, and teaching ourselves to look into a different way. And so I think that it's really valuable to know where you are on those zones and be able to see that. Because if you can say, hey, we're actually in this achievement zone, we have high accountability, high psychological safety, we're meeting our goals. So what that means is that we're doing good at this, and we can continue to reward that with other good things, and see that as the new problem of maybe the boredom, but how can we keep this level going for, you know, the length of your company?
So with the achievement zone, like it's really funny. I've tested it with thousands of leaders around the world. And, you know, some leaders will just say, hey, I'm in the achievement zone. I've been there for years. And I just try not to laugh because there's no way possible. Even I know I'm not in the achievement zone. I'm in and out of so many of them. And that's normal. It's not normal to think, hey, I'm fantastic, so I'm in the achievement zone all the time. That does not make you a trusted leader because you're not owning up to the issues. So,
It's really powerful to say, though, like to understand that movement and flow. That's what life is. It's this movement and flow and this back and forth and up and down. It's not like always being static. It's that movement. And so that's the whole point of why you're talking about trust, though. I'm understanding it was, you have to maintain it because there's that ebb and flow and things come up and life changes, you know.
Exactly.
It's always that work that has to be done.
And you have to be honest with yourself. Unfortunately, as human beings, we do tend to overestimate our abilities to build trust and our strengths. And so it is really important that leaders don't just assume, you know, going back to what I was saying before, and that they check in with people. So it's really important that on a regular basis, leaders sit with their team. And, you know, there are two questions they can ask. So the first one is, on a scale of 1 to 10, how accountable would you say your team are to getting things done on time and to the right standard? And so having your team members come up with a number is really helpful. And then the second question is, on a scale of 1 to 10, how safe would you say you feel around making a mistake? Now, of course, if this is a tricky one, because people won't necessarily say they feel unsafe to their leader when they feel unsafe.
I was going to say that. So how do you put this survey out there? Because someone's not going to tell me, if they don't trust me, they're not going to tell me the truth about on that scale. They're going to be like, it's a 9 here. And then they're going to go, my boss, they're going to go home and say some bad things, you know? So how do you do that in a way that builds trust? Hey, thanks so much for listening. Since you've listened this far, it tells me you're really enjoying the content. And I'm so grateful. I work really hard to bring you some awesome resources to help really enhance your leadership game. If you're liking this, can you pause really quickly? Make sure you're subscribed, but then also share with one person or more people who you think could really benefit from the content. My goal is to really bring this into some of the top podcasts on leadership in the world, and you can help get there and help us grow by sharing this with everyone you know. Thank you so much. I'm glad you're enjoying the episode.
Well, there are two ways. So some companies do get an external person like me, because I have my own assessments that I use. And so then it's impartial, and people will fill that out knowing that the boss isn't going to see who they are and it's all confidential. And then I bring those results into a workshop. So, for example, there was a team that I was working with. The CEO actually said that he was creating safety. He rated himself quite low, so 4 out of 10, and the rest of his team on average were 6 out of 10. So that was actually a positive sign. You know, I'm always a bit concerned when a leader says, hey, I'm creating lots of safety, and everyone else is going, no, you're not. We have a bit of a chat over that one. But you can do it that way. Or another way is, you know, there's lots of software products out there that do enable teams to ask questions of their teams, and it can be impartial. So off the top of my head, I think it's like Culture Amp. There are a whole lot of things, 15.5, those sorts of things. So, you know, it's done, you know, quick 5-minute thing or 2-minute thing that people could do. And then that could be set up in a team meeting to discuss.
And how often are you asking these questions? Is this like, would you notice the problem and you're going to ask this question? Or is this what we're going to ask every month? I mean, how often are you coming back and doing these assessments?
Yeah, it's really something that you do with your team once a month, and even just one-on-one. But it's something that you have to build up to. You know that you've got issues if your employees won't talk about stuff. So I recently had someone tell me, well, I have a staff member, she's young, she won't tell me. She won't tell me stuff. I don't know about you, but I know when I started my career, I never told anyone anything. You know, everything was great. Yeah, great. And of course it wasn't, but you're too scared. You're really, really scared.
Because you have to learn to trust.
And you don't think you're valuable, or anyone will believe you, or you'll get up, people will tell you off. So what this team did, because she did have a couple of young junior members who were just, you know, not even really taught culturally to speak up, you know, particularly for girls, it can be quite hard, was that she'd show the 4 team zones and have conversations around that. And, you know, what does, you know, who thinks this is the anxiety zone? What would that look like in our team? You know, really opening up that conversation and taking people on a journey that way. And then, you know, once you start stabilizing stuff and people are being more open, then, you know, you only have to measure it, you know, every, you know, 6 months. But it gives you benchmark data as well that can be quite helpful, that shows you how your team is progressing.
I really love that question, though. What would that look like? You know, you start with the what, so you're not asking why. You're not putting anybody on defensive. You're not saying that it is like that already. You're really encouraging people to offer their own input when you ask that question. What would that look like? What would it look like for you? Mm-hmm. And you also, that allows someone to say, well, I feel like I'm there already. I feel like we're there. Awesome. Great.
Yeah.
Five. But
yeah,
that I also have now given you a safe space to say, oh, it would look like a lot of things changing.
Yeah. And it's just having conversations. So one of the things I do in my book quite a lot is I give leaders the questions to ask their team to, you know, constantly be building that safety and connection and meaningful future.
Yeah. Okay. So if you haven't read her book yet, pick it up, Trusted to Thrive. We're talking about this a lot. And there are some things in there that I find really, really helpful is that at the end of every chapter, you have these reflection questions. You also have a lot of case studies in there. So there's some stories that are really helpful and things to relate to. But you do, you have these topics saying, focus on this, okay, here's the main idea. Now, this is how you actually do it. And it makes it really, really simple to come in and go, okay, I can find where I'm struggling right now. Now, what do I do? It's like almost a playbook. I mean, you can just open it up and follow along. And it's really empowering to read these questions and realize, okay, I can do something different this time. And it's like taking ownership for yourself of where you are. And I don't think it really even has to be a leader. This is for any employee, for people who are wanting to have better relationships with their job. I think it's really, really, really powerful. So I want to just ask you a few questions before, like, we're kind of coming towards the end here, but there's a couple of things we haven't touched on yet. And I really want to do that. I'm wondering if you can just give me, like, quickly, we've already talked about it a little bit, but what are some of the top things that someone needs to do to really build trust?
Yeah. So the top one is to be self-aware. So working on yourself and your behaviors and how you're leading. So just every week, just doing a little reflection, 10 minutes journaling. How did I build trust this week? What could I do better? You know, how am I building safety? Those sorts of questions. That's a really important foundational technique. The second one,
I start asking this about my kids. How did I build trust with my kids?
Yeah, gosh, they'll come up with stuff that sometimes are out of your control. The second one is, and these are techniques I talk more fully in the book is, you know, building that safe environment that works for each individual and helping people feel connected to the organization, understanding the meaning of their work and having those conversations about it regularly. And then really tying people into the exciting future where they see themselves, where the company's going, and having those conversations because, you know, our brains work that we're constantly scanning the environment to see if we're safe. So if we don't see that there's a future for us in our team or that there is a career opportunities, we tend to withdraw our commitment. So it's really balancing those three things that really help leaders create that thriving, trusted environment for everyone, including themselves.
What's cool about this is the way that you've laid that out, building connection, meaning to the work, asking those questions, bringing other people into the team and the environment, being self-aware. These are things that you can do working in any job, whether even a remote job when you have employees scattered all over the world. When you're thinking about it in those terms, it makes answering the other questions like, well, how do I get to know this person? Or how do I achieve more goals here? How do we bring our team together? When you're not thinking about some of those minute things, you're seeing, okay, now instead I'm going to ask, how do I bring meaning to this? How do I build connections? And that will start to answer some of your other questions, I think. So it's really, really important. My next question is, how do you rebuild trust when it's broken?
Oh, so that's, as I said, it's a really difficult process. It takes time, but it's really about, you know, really it's, I've got a process for this, but it's quite complicated. But essentially it's about assessing whether it's worth rebuilding and whether the other person wants to rebuild it. Because if the other person isn't interested, then you're wasting your time because you won't be able to do anything. So if you've been the one at fault, then you've really got to make the effort, explain what you did, why you did it, how you didn't mean to hurt them, or, you know, let them talk about what upset them, how you could improve, and just really open up that conversation. And then on a regular basis, every week, you want to show that you can be more trustworthy based on what they're saying they need from you. And it could be a variety of things from, you know, checking in and seeing how they are, or, you know, supporting them in their career, or giving them opportunities to work on different projects. There's a range of things, but you need to check in with that person.
The last person I interviewed from Australia talked about open, honest, hard conversations. So having those vulnerable, open, honest conversations is what I'm hearing from you too, is ownership, owning that and being responsible for your role in something and then being willing to have a hard conversation around it and that open, honest environment.
Yeah, so when in the because I do a lot of research in companies, and one of the biggest complaints people will say about leaders are leaders who won't admit their mistakes or admit to any wrongdoing, even when they did something wrong. You know, they get defensive and angry. So, you know, if you're not doing that and you're owning up to what you did wrong and then actually trying to do something about it and taking action, that's the most critical thing.
Yeah, wow. I feel like we can just keep going into that and going into that, but I'm gonna, for the interest of time, my next question is, how do you manage trust in the middle of a great deal of stress, like a pandemic, or like maybe something just really flops at work, or there's just a trauma or a really bad situation, a major failure, or just you guys have a lot of projects going on. We have 17 projects that we're working on right now and our team can't handle all of these things. How do you build and manage that kind of trust when you're in a survival mode situation that's out of your control?
Yeah, so this is a tricky one, and you get better at this as you get older, but it's, you know, managing your emotions, not getting angry or swearing like, which I used to do when things get tough, because your people see that and it puts them into fear. So managing that, which is, you know, really kind of a big thing to do. And then just being honest with your people about what's going on and how tough it is, getting them to share their feelings. It's really important to have those check-ins with how people are feeling emotionally. So maybe at the start of the meeting, saying on a scale of 1 to 10, you know, how are you feeling right now with your workload? And then having discussions with that and helping people help them get through those roadblocks if there are any as well. Again, this is one of the models I unpack in the book. It's about creating that constant safety, future, and connection. So last year, my family went through a whole lot of issues. Like, we were living in a tiny house while we renovated. When both of my children started having anxiety issues, one was suicidal, and things got really, really hard. And the child that was suicidal, and I didn't know how bad it was, I realized I was in the process of editing my book and finalizing it. And I realized, oh my gosh, I need to practice what I'm preaching in my book. So I worked on the safety aspect, and they didn't feel safe because their father was telling them off a lot. So I worked on him, fixed that up. And then I worked on the connection piece, so constantly connecting with them in a way that suited them, because they were quite reclusive. So we'd go for a walk every day and where they could talk. And then the future aspect, I need to anchor them into something that was exciting and something for them to live for. So we planned on seeing Harry Potter when, you know, because we're in lockdown when the pandemic ended. So it worked amazingly. And even for my other child who got diagnosed with autism, who's just turned 18, I worked on those things as well. And that really steadied them both. And, you know, what I say in my book, that trust is really beating heart of a successful team. And so when you actually work on those three factors, they do catalyze to create that beating heart of the team where people feel supported and cared for, which is what everybody wants.
Wow. That's a really powerful example of your daughters too, how stepping back again, slowing down and attending, paying attention, completely made a huge and significant difference in their lives. It's really powerful.
Yes. And we're over the worst now. Everything's stabilized, which is really.
That's amazing. That's really cool. So, you know, you did mention when we talked about broken trust, that sometimes there is times when we can acknowledge that it's just not working and that we just need to let go and move on. How do you notice that? You know, because sometimes that can feel hard. It feels like I failed, or we did something wrong, or, you know, we use the should have word a lot, the should word. It should have been different. It should have been better. We should be able to fix this. We should be able to make it work. But sometimes you just can't. And how do we deal with that and work through that?
Yeah. So one of the things is really letting go of our need to think that we can build trust with everyone, because you can't. So you do have to watching those consistent behaviors over time. So it is time to let someone go if they are violent, if they are angry, if they are defensive, refusing to acknowledge that they've done anything wrong, refusing to learn, refusing to change. You know, they're people who are narcissistic, sociopathic, they can't change. So to give you just a kind of an example, we hired a builder last year to build the frame of our house. And he just seemed amazing, just seemed to be in alignment with us, with what we were trying to achieve, and just really lovely and sweet. And we had things in common we could talk about. The first day he and his team worked, he ignored me and pretended I wasn't there. He looked the other way. And he told my husband off and went into a screaming match with him. And we were both shocked, because we thought he was this amazing person that was just friendly and sweet like us. And we even went up, my husband wanted to appease him and, hey, you know, we can't, this is how we need to work. We need to communicate like this. He just locked himself away in his car and refused to talk to us. And I knew at that moment that we'd made a huge mistake. First day of work. So, and things got worse from there, and terrible thing, you know, he did terrible things and horrible stuff, and I wish we'd got rid of him sooner, but, you know, we paid a deposit, a little bit different than in the workplace. But, you know, when you have someone like that, yeah, don't even bother, just walk away.
And you never know what that person's going through and dealing with in their own life, if that's just their personality or if there's something going on with them. But regardless, it's not going to be safe for that person to continue to work with you or you in that situation. That makes sense. Sometimes it's wise. It's not like failing. It's acknowledging what's best for both of us in this situation.
But it's like that saying, how you do anything is how you do everything. You know, if someone's doing that once or twice, you know, that's just part of who they are. And until they do the work on themselves, then, you know, you just don't want to be working with them.
Yeah. Well, this has been really, really awesome. I am excited to read your book again. And I really hope that people will pick it up, because I think it was extremely valuable. I really do think everyone should read it. Before we go, I do want to ask you my famous questions this season is, what does integrity look like and mean to you?
Yeah, so integrity is a really big one. To me, it's being, are you trusted to do the right thing? You know, integrity we can unpack in so many ways, but how I see it is that, you know, it's like when you were at school and you saw the popular kids bullying the underdog. You know, did you walk past and do nothing about it? Did you even pick on the underdog and side with the bullies because they had the power? That's where you really see who has integrity. And as leaders, do you bat for your employee when they're going through people picking on them? I actually had a guy that I was interviewing who was pretty much in tears in his late 40s because his boss just listened to something a horrible person at that organization said about him that wasn't true. So to me, integrity is really doing the right things by people, even when it's hard.
Yeah, yeah. Well, what about balance? And we've talked about that a few times here too. We talked about boundaries and balancing out different things. And it's balance means different to everybody depending on the context. So you just whatever that looks like and means to you. I'm just curious because I want us to be people who can do great things for long term. And one way that we can do that is making sure we are balanced in who we are. So I would love to hear from you though. What does that look like and what does that mean to you?
Yeah. So to me, learning how to be in balance is really about learning how to manage being human. It's part of our journey.
Mm.
And there's always things we have to learn to balance, and there's always things that go out of balance. So balancing personal issues and work issues, our health and work, and, you know, it's just a constant thing we have to manage every day and not beating ourselves up when things go out of whack. And, you know, when things go out of whack, your health gets impacted.
Yeah. Well, we did talk about it earlier too, you know, when we were talking about the like being in different zones and how you're not always in one space, you kind of move and you bounce and you go back and forth and understanding that is what life is. It's that ebb and flow and the movement, like the waves. We talked about that earlier. I don't know if that's in this episode, we were chatting about it, but how waves do have that back and forth and they're never the same, but yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah.
I do want to know, how can we find you? Where can we get in touch with you? How can our listeners find your book and find you?
Yeah, you can come to my website, which is marieclaireross.com. And there's a hyphen in the middle of the Marie and the Claire. And you can download a free chapter of the book as well. It's also available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Walmart, anywhere it's available to help you on your journey. And you can always connect with me on LinkedIn as well.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, is there anything else you want to make sure you have? I want to make sure you have not left anything unsaid. Is there anything else you'd like our listeners to hear today?
Well, it's, you know, I suppose one of the key messages that it is that trust really is, you know, it's not about what we say, it's about what we do. So, you know, being really conscious of your behaviors, both verbal and nonverbal, and checking in with people as to how they're receiving what you're sending out, because that's where the real gold is. And through learning through that and getting that feedback, we can really improve where we are and improve our self-awareness as well, which is crucial to all of this. So it's that constant checking in and not being afraid to find out from people how they think you're performing and how they think you're behaving, particularly those that are the recipients of that, rather than just assuming that we're great because we're who we are, because that really causes more issues long term.
Yeah. You know, something that just made me think too is I remember somebody told me one time, it sounds like you're fishing for a compliment. And so I'm remembering them saying that to me and thinking about this, approaching these conversations, not as a, so how am I doing? How am I doing? Really? You want to tell me good things about myself? Like, but finding ways to approach that and that are honest and sincere of wanting realistic feedback. I struggle with that personally. Yeah.
It's about being more specific with how you ask the questions. So it could be, you know, what can I do to build connection with you? What can I improve? So it's not so much about asking how you're doing. So maybe I worded that wrongly, but it's about checking in with what they're getting and what they need to improve. And you could even ask, you know, what's working, you know, what's not working. Just checking in that way and being specific with what you want.
Specific questions. I love that. Cool. Marie Claire, thank you so much for this wonderful conversation and for your patience with me and for just walking us through your book and walking us through all these steps. I just think that it's so valuable and I've learned a lot. I'm really grateful to you for taking the time to share with me today.
Thank you. My pleasure, Carla. It's been lots of fun. Really enjoyed it. Great questions.
Hey, thank you so much for listening. If you've liked what you heard and you want some more tools and resources to help you on your journey, go check out kylakofer.com/free stuff.